Good afternoon. My name is Pete Makopoulos-Senftleber. I'm a staff attorney here at Lone Star Legal Aid with our Medical Legal Partnership Unit. And today I'm going to talk a bit about employee rights in Texas. I'm actually going to talk a lot about employee rights in Texas. This is going to be an overview of a few different things. I'll try to stay within time, but we're going to cover quite a bit of ground, as you'll see in the roadmap we get to. So a disclaimer, an anti-discrimination statement, Lone Star Legal Aid strives to update all materials to account for changes in applicable laws. This presentation is based upon the law at the time it was created. The law changes frequently and is subject to various interpretations by different courts. Future changes in the law may make some of the information in this presentation inaccurate. This presentation is intended to serve as legal information and is not intended to and does not replace an attorney's advice or assistance based on your particular situation. This presentation does not constitute legal advice nor form an attorney-client relationship between you and Lone Star Legal Aid or any of its attorneys. Contact Lone Star Legal Aid at 1-800-733-8394 or go to http://www.lonestarlegalaid.org for more information on legal assistance. Lone Star Legal Aid does not discriminate on the basis of race, color, religion, gender, gender expression, sexual orientation, age, national origin, ancestry, disability, marital status, or military status in any of its activities or operations. So again, I'm going to cover a lot of different topics today. This is going to be a really broad overview, but we're going to cover wage and hour protections, including overtime, minimum wage, and tips, the FMLA and ADA and disability insurance and kind of the interplay between those things, and wrongful termination, including discrimination and harassment and whistleblower retaliation. Again, we're not going to be able to get into the nitty-gritty on any of these topics, but I will be able to answer questions at the end of this. So if you have any questions, please feel free to type them out and I will get to them at the end of this presentation. So a background about wage and hour laws. The backbone of wage and hour laws is the Fair Labor Standards Act, or FLSA. The FLSA was originally implemented in 1938 during the Great Depression to improve working conditions. At the time, as you can imagine, there were really poor labor standards, child labor was normal, ridiculously long grueling hours were normal, and unfair pay were just kind of the common practice. The FLSA established a few key principles that we know today to be the cornerstone of the American employment scheme. And that includes a minimum wage, the 40-hour work week, and the requirement to pay overtime for hours worked over 40 in a work week. And it also set minimum ages for dangerous jobs, so there are no more 8-year-olds working at steel mills. Today, the most commonly litigated or sued over aspect of the FLSA is overtime. Nearly every employer must abide by the provisions of the FLSA. And you'll see later in this presentation why that's important, because a lot of other employment statutes only apply to employers that are at least, you know, on the medium side or larger. The FLSA applies to nearly every employer. The way to think about overtime under the FLSA, which is a really complicated portion of a complicated statute, is as a general rule and an exception. The general rule, the thing that should apply to most people, is that people who work more than 40 hours per week must be paid at a rate of 1.5 times their pay for all hours worked over 40 in a work week. That's a fancy way of saying, if I'm an employee that works 45 hours in one work week, for 40 of those hours, I should be paid my regular rate of pay. And for the 5 hours that I worked over 40, I should be paid 1.5 times that. The exception to this rule is that some employees are exempt from overtime because of how they're paid, how much they are paid, and their job duties. And we'll talk about that test. But there is quite a large portion of the population that's considered salaried or classified as exempt from overtime that should not be. And that's why there's so many lawsuits based on this. So if you're an hourly or non-exempt employee, your employer has to track quite a few things: personal information, including your name, home address, your occupation, the hour and day your work week begins. That can be, you know, a Monday through a Sunday, a Wednesday through a Tuesday. It really just depends on how the employer classifies what is their 7-day work week. the total hours worked each workday and work week, the total daily or straight or weekly straight time earnings. So what you earned for working 40 hours in a week or however many hours in a day, your regular pay rate for any week overtime has worked, the total overtime pay for the work week, deductions or additions to wages. So, you know, when you get your taxes taken out or health insurance, or if you get bonuses or extra additional things to your wages, it should track those. And the total wages paid each pay period. So these are things you commonly see on a pay stub. Those are things that employers must track for hourly or non-exempt employees, and they can be penalized for not having accurate or adequate record keeping. And it can also mean trouble for them if they ever get sued and don't track some of these things, because it means the employee's word or other things might be considered better evidence than whatever it is they have or don't have. So exempt employees, these are sometimes referred to as salaried employees or employees that are not paid overtime. There's generally a three-part test to qualify for exemption from overtime. And it's intended to be a little bit difficult, and it's intended to exclude a good portion of the population, because remember, the goal of the FLSA when it was enacted in 1938 was to make the wage conditions and working conditions better for employees. So this was supposed to be only for a select group of people that should not be qualified as hourly employees. So the employees must be paid on a predetermined and on a fixed basis. This is sometimes called the salary basis. That's the first part of the test. The second part of the test is that the salary they get must meet a minimum specified amount. This is called the salary level. And then the third part is that the job that the employee performs must primarily involve certain duties. This is called the duties test. So again, it's a little bit difficult. There's three hoops to jump through, and the employer has to show that the employee meets all three criteria in order to deny paying that employee overtime and be able to pay them on a salary basis. So the salary basis is the first portion of this test to determine if somebody should be appropriately paid on a salary basis and not exempt from overtime. And it should be a predetermined amount of compensation each pay period, meaning it shouldn't fluctuate with how many hours the employee worked or how good their work is. As you'll see at the bottom, the predetermined salary cannot be reduced based on the quality or quantity of the work performed. And generally, a salary is not subject to deductions. There are very few exceptions. The appealing part of a salary used to be and should be that, for example, if you have to go to a doctor's appointment and take a couple hours off, leave early on a Wednesday, your pay shouldn't be reduced because you just took a couple of hours off of work, or because you didn't work exactly 40 hours in that work week. Your pay should be the same consistently. It should be a predetermined amount that's not reduced. If an employer is deducting from your salary, reducing it based on the quality or quantity of work you perform, then that employer should not be allowed to use this exemption to paying you overtime and should have to pay you on an hourly basis. The next is salary level. An employer can't say, we're going to give you a salary, we're going to pay you $40 per week. That won't fly and exempt the employer from overtime. What they have to do is pay you at least $684 per week, or $35,568 per year, which is what that per week amount translates to if you're good at math. That salary level must be met. Otherwise, again, the employer is in violation of the FLSA because it's not appropriately paying you the salary, and they need to be paying you on an hourly basis, and you should be entitled to overtime pay. And finally is the duties test. This is the third prong of the test to determine if you're appropriately classified as exempt from overtime. The employee's primary duty must involve certain types of work as defined by regulations. The primary duty means the principal, main, or most important duty that the employee performs. Generally, employees who spend more than 50% of their time performing exempt work will be found to satisfy the primary duty requirement. This primary duty doesn't have to be the thing you spend the most amount of time on, but it usually is. So for example, if you're a store manager and you spend 90% of your time managing the store and doing duties that are exempt, but then 10% of the day, you sometimes help out on the front end, helping cashiers or sweep the parking lot or just do things to get your store by, even though that 10% of the time you're doing non-exempt duties, you still are an exempt employee if you meet the other prongs of the test. There's different types of exemptions and exempt duties. These can get really complicated, so it's easier to think about them just by examples. The first type of exemption is executive. And basically, this is for an employee whose primary duty is managing the company or a department or subdivision of the company. And that employee is regularly managing or supervising at least two other full-time employees, and they have the authority to hire and fire those employees. So things like a shift manager or somebody that only has the authority to make a recommendation or write somebody up is probably not exempt. But if they have the actual authority to hire and fire employees, they may be able to be classified as an exempt employee under the executive exemption. Examples of folks that fit under the executive exemption are CEOs, supervisors, and managers. Another set of exemptions are the professional exemptions. There are two types of professional exemptions. They're the learned professional and the creative professional. The learned professional's primary duty must be mostly intellectual and include a consistent exercise of discretion and judgment in a field of science or learning. Mm-hmm. Typically, this knowledge has to be acquired through a prolonged course of specialized intellectual instruction. So examples of this are doctors, lawyers, engineers. These are folks that are often exempt from overtime and can be classified as salary. The creative professional is another type that can be exempt. This employee's primary duty must be in the performance of work requiring creative work in a recognized artistic field. So writers, actors, artists, you know, actors spend all their time prepping for roles. They don't track all that time. They're exempt from overtime, and that's under the creative professional exemption. And finally, the administrative exemption is another popular exemption. This requires the employee to perform non-manual work directly related to management or the general business operations of the employer or the employer's customers. It also requires that employee to exercise discretion and independent judgment with respect to matters of significance. So that doesn't mean the employee is allowed to pick if we're going to order the copy paper that is a little bit thicker than another. It means the employee has to make real-world decisions that matter to the business. How the company is going to be organized, what particular vendors that they're going to use, the systems, processes, policies, all that stuff. This employee is making those decisions. Simply put, this employee has to be in the driver's seat for the majority of their job function. You can think about folks that may qualify under the administrative exemption as compliance individuals, people that work in accounting, HR professionals, and office managers, and not just lower level employees in these roles, but folks that have decision-making authority and ability and can and do make those decisions. So how do employers typically violate the FLSA's overtime pay requirements? An employer might pay an employee a day rate or a flat rate. They'll say, we'll give you $50 per day for your work, and that may violate the FLSA's overtime pay requirements because it doesn't account for your total hours worked or if you worked overtime in that work week. Some employers don't track employee time. So they'll just say, we're going to pay you this amount, and they don't even track your hours to know if they're paying you for the correct amount of hours or for your overtime rate. Some employers pay employees as independent contractors when they should be classified as employees. Independent contractors are intended to be a very small portion of the population. The IRS usually estimates about 1% to 3% of people should be independent contractors. These should be folks like a residential plumber that you hire to come out every once in a while, or someone working on a short project for a finite period of time. It's not meant to be someone in a long-term employment relationship with a company. Then that person should probably be an employee. And by paying them as an independent contractor, you're probably not paying them pursuant to the FLSA. A lot of times employers will misclassify non-exempt employees as salaried employees. So sometimes people will think, oh, I'm being paid a salary, so this is how much I should be paid no matter how much I work. But if you don't fit into the exemption categories that we described, or the employer doesn't pay you a fixed amount, or the employer does not pay you the salary minimum, you know, that $35,000+ per year, then you may be misclassified and entitled to overtime pay. Again, they might violate that salary basis requirement. So they might take off because, you know, you skipped out a few hours earlier, they didn't like the job you did that week. Those deductions are not permissible for the employer so that they're still allowed to pay you on a salary basis. Sometimes employers won't pay employees for working meal breaks. So for example, if you have to be ready and available and working while you're eating, or you're actually working while you're eating, then that isn't technically a meal break and you should be paid for that. Sometimes employers don't, and the employee may be entitled to get compensation for that time. Or sometimes employers will not pay for off-the-clock work. So you finish your workday at the office, you go home, then your employer calls you and says, hey, can you take out your laptop and, you know, type this up, email up and send it out to so-and-so? That's work that you probably should be compensated for. And if you're not tracking that time and not getting paid for that, and you're an hourly employee, you probably should be. And that might be a way your employer is violating the FLSA. These are common ways employers usually violate the FLSA's other requirements. So not just the overtime aspect, which, as I said, was one of the most common ways employers break the law, but how they violate other provisions. So some employers don't pay the minimum wage for each hour worked. Federally and in Texas, that amount is $7.25 per hour. Unless you're a tipped employee, in which it's $2.13 per hour, and they need to pay that as well. Some employers also keep an employee's tips. Managers and supervisors may not keep tips received by employees, including through tip pools. So if you're an employee that gets tips and your employer, your manager, supervisor, company owner is taking a cut of them, even through a tip pool, that's probably in violation of the FLSA, and you may be entitled to get your tip compensation back through that unlawful pooling. And employers are not allowed to retaliate against employees for wage and hour questions or complaints. So doing things like telling your employer that you think you should be paid on an hourly basis, or that you're entitled to overtime, that your check's wrong, that you want a copy of your pay stubs, or you want to see your hours worked. If your employer retaliates against you by demoting you, firing you, writing you up, doing any of those things, those are actionable retaliation actions that the employee can try to either sue or otherwise come after the employer for. So a common question that I often hear is, I think I'm owed money, what can I do? You know, my employer, I think, shorted me on my check, or they should have been paying me overtime and they didn't. Well, the first thing you can do is you can discuss your pay issues with your employer. Preferably, you should do this in a written or some recorded way. If you're doing it by phone or in person, you know, make a quick audio recording or a video recording. Phones are a blessing and a curse that way. Texas is a one-party consent state, so you don't have to get approval from the other party when you're making a recording of a conversation you're having. You can, as long as you are the person consenting to it while you're doing the recording, you can record that conversation. And the reason why it's good to have this recorded or in written format is to show that you actually did bring those issues to your employer's attention. So this way, if they retaliate against you unlawfully for bringing those issues to your attention, to their attention, you have a record of doing that. And it makes it a lot easier to prove a retaliation case if you can show, hey, on Monday, I sent my boss this email saying I should be paid overtime, and on Tuesday, he fired me. That makes a much cleaner retaliation claim for any potential lawsuit that or complaint that you may file. You can also file a complaint with the Department of Labor. You can do so online or in paper form. You can go on their website or just search wage complaint, DOL, or Department of Labor, and links to do that will show up. Or you can file a complaint with the Texas Workforce Commission. They have an arm of their agency that works on these wage claims and will try to get your owed wages back for you if they can. You can again do that online or in paper form. And if you go on their website, it lists ways to do that. It's recommended that you act quickly because limitations periods apply to these claims for wages, either under the FLSA or otherwise. And a real issue is sometimes people will be in a job where they think they're entitled to overtime for 5 years, and they will just never bring it up to their employer and then want to sue and get all 5 years back. Unfortunately, the limitations periods for things like overtime or pay under the FLSA can be up to 3 years, but it's usually only 2 years. And so if you have a 5, 10, 20 year employment history, you can't reach all the way back in time that far and get those wages. You're only going to be able to reach back 2 or a maximum of 3 years. So it can significantly limit the amount of damages that you have. So that's wage and hour law. I'm going to try to quickly address three separate issues that employees usually have when it comes to taking time off or getting accommodations for things like medical issues or the health of their family members. And these are the FMLA, the ADA, and employer leave. So leave generally, employers are not required to provide even a single hour of time off like vacation or sick time. But a lot of employers are required to provide you with leave under the FMLA and or the ADA. And they can offer additional time if they would like to. So a brief history of the FMLA and the ADA. The FMLA was passed in 1993 to give employees the ability to take unpaid leave. To this day, we're one of very few first world countries that does not have a time off requirement for employers to provide their employees. And so the FMLA that was enacted just about 30 years ago was a way to allow employees to get at least unpaid time off when life happened to them. The unfortunate part of the FMLA is only about 60% of the workforce is covered because this only applies to certain employers. And I'll cover the criteria of what employers are covered and which aren't in just a moment. The ADA was drafted because there was a growing movement for differently abled folks to be able to live independently and not just be institutionalized as they had been not that long ago. And the ADA was passed in 1990. The ADA thankfully applies to more employers than the FMLA, but there's still criteria employers have to meet. So don't think that every employer has to comply with the FMLA or the ADA. This chart kind of shows who has to follow what and why. So does my employer have to abide by or provide blank? First, let's tackle the FMLA. If an employer has 50 or more employees within a 75-mile radius or is a public agency or school, an elementary or secondary school, they are generally a covered employer under the FMLA, meaning they should provide it to their employees. The employee, if they would like to take FMLA leave, must have been employed for at least 12 months prior to taking the leave. So if you start a new job in January and you want to take FMLA leave this month, even if you have a covered, you work for a covered employer, you cannot. You have to wait at least 12 months and be employed by that employer for at least 12 months prior to the start of your leave. And you also have to work at least 1,250 hours prior to taking the leave. So if you worked for a full year, but you only work 2 hours a week on a very small part-time basis, you won't be entitled to take FMLA leave at your covered employer. The employee must have a serious health condition, or there must be a serious health condition of a covered family member that the employee is taking the leave to help care for them for, or the employee can take time off for the birth, adoption, or placement of a child in their home. Does your employer have to abide by or provide ADA accommodations? Well, a covered employer under the ADA is an employer that has 15 or more employees. So not 50 like the FMLA, 15. So that covers a much wider range of employers, everything except very small businesses. This only uncovers the employee's disability, not the disability of an employee's family members. So under the FMLA, if you have a sick parent, grandparent, child, you can take time off, you can take your FMLA leave to care for them. Under the ADA, you don't have that. You can only get accommodations for things that are happening to you, the employee. So it's a little bit different. It applies to a smaller scope of issues. And then short-term or long-term disability, when I say this, I'm talking about disability insurance or insurance coverage. This is never required by law. This is something that an employer may electively provide to their employees. And those benefits are governed by the private insurance plan that you may sign up for through the employer or on your own. And it generally only covers the employee, not the employee's family. So it's similar to the ADA in that regard. What do these things actually provide, practically speaking, to the employee? The FMLA provides unpaid time off of up to 12 weeks in a 12-month period. This would be increased to actually 26 weeks in a 12-month period if you're taking the time off to care for a current service member in the U.S. Armed Forces. So it's some extra time if you're doing that. But if it's just for any other reason, then it's only 12 weeks in a 12-month period. And it can be intermittent. That means that you don't have to take all 12 weeks at one time. So if you have a condition that qualifies for leave under the FMLA, but say, for example, you just need to take 3 hours off per week or 2 days off per week to go to physical therapy or something for your condition, you can use that leave intermittently up to 12 weeks with the permission of your employer. And the FMLA requires that the employer restores the employee to the same or nearly identical job with the same pay, benefits, and terms and conditions of employment once they return from their leave. The employer must continue the employee's health insurance as if the employee was not on leave. So even though you're out of work, you're not on leave, you're taking your FMLA time, you should still have your health insurance plan continued. The ADA provides for unpaid leave or other reasonable accommodation that does not impose undue hardship on the employer. The employer must continue the employee health insurance as if the employee was not on leave if the employer continues benefits for employees on similar leave. So that means the employer has to cover your health insurance if they would allow, say, you know, you, Mr. Smith, want to take or need to take 3 weeks off as a reasonable accommodation under the ADA. And Ms. Jones also takes 3 weeks off, but she does so because she's going on a cruise and she takes unpaid personal leave. If they're not going to terminate Ms. Jones's health insurance while she's on unpaid personal leave, then they should not terminate your health insurance, Mr. Smith, if you're taking your time off for an ADA covered reason. So they need to treat the employees similarly or the same, ideally. And then short or long-term disability, what does this provide? And again, this is insurance coverage. Short-term usually provides 3 months to 1 year, and long-term usually provides 2 years or more, and can last all the way up till retirement, in income benefits. Typically, it provides a percentage of your income, usually around 60%, and it does not provide job protection or continued health coverage like the FMLA and ADA do, because again, this is a separate either private or employer-sponsored insurance policy you can get, not a statutory right that you have like the FMLA and the ADA are. So what do these cover? I talked about these briefly, but the FMLA covers a serious health condition that makes the employee unable to perform essential functions of your job. It also covers care for an employee's spouse, child, or parent with a serious health condition, or care or bonding time with a newborn child or adopted or foster child within 1 year of birth or placement. And then again, it also provides for care for a current service member, a child, spouse, parent, or next of kin receiving medical treatment, recuperation, therapy, or a service member in an outpatient status or a service member on temporary disability retired list for a serious injury or illness sustained in the line of duty or aggravated by service in the line of duty. The ADA, what this covers, the ADA requires employers to provide reasonable accommodation, which can include leave, but also include other things like more accessible facilities, special equipment, modified scheduling, and other things, whatever is a reasonable accommodation to allow an employee to continue to do their job. An employee has to have a physical or mental impairment that substantially limits one or more major life activities to be covered under the ADA. They also may have a record of such an impairment, so you had a history of having that impairment, or be regarded as having such an impairment. That last part is more important for ADA retaliation claims. So, for example, if you didn't have an ADA-covered disability, but your employer thought you had or treated you as if you had, then you may be covered by some of the ADA's protections. Disabilities are not laid out in a list of covered disabilities under the ADA. They're assessed on a case-by-case basis. But some conditions that are usually held to be disabilities under the ADA are diabetes, HIV/AIDS, PTSD, autism, cerebral palsy, multiple sclerosis, muscular dystrophy, bipolar, depression, OCD, schizophrenia, epilepsy, and hundreds, thousands of other conditions. And again, these are case-by-case basis assessed. Accommodations are considered reasonable so long as they don't create an undue hardship or direct threat to the employer. And again, it can range from different things like time off to adding a ramp to the front of your employer, providing you with special equipment like a better chair if you had a disability like say back pain or something like that, or modified scheduling, you know, shifting your hours. Determinations of accommodations reasonableness and whether or not they pose an undue hardship to the company are also made on a case-by-case basis. So there's not just a list of here are reasonable accommodations. It's going to vary based on the employee and the employer. What short-term or long-term disability covers, it really depends on the plan terms. Again, this is a private insurance policy or an employer-sponsored private insurance policy. They generally don't cover work-related injuries. These are usually covered by workers' compensation insurance, which was a whole nother discussion. And some plans follow the ADA's definition of disability to determine if an employee qualifies or not, but other plans have more restrictive definitions and some plans have less restrictive definitions. So it really just depends on the terms of the plan that you have. Frequently asked questions about the FMLA and ADA. What type of information can my employer request for FMLA leave or an ADA accommodation? So an employer can and likely will ask you for information regarding what conditions necessitate the leave or accommodation that you're seeking, how the condition impacts your work, and the approximate duration of your need for leave. For accommodations, the employer can ask for information regarding the needs you have and specific recommendations to accommodate those leave. So for example, not just I have 3 herniated discs and I have a back condition. They also want to know what they need to do, what accommodations you require to do your job. So I have 3 herniated discs and I need a special chair for my desk. And I also need to be able to stand for 5 minutes every hour. Here's an example of a form for an FMLA request that an employer might use. This is just kind of a standard form. They might have their own form or no form at all and just ask these questions informally. But as you can see, it asks for medical information, the amount of leave you need, and you know, a description about when you might be back, and then how it impacts your essential job functions. How do you guys start the process of requesting FMLA leave or an ADA accommodation? So the good news about this is there's no magic language or special words you have to use. So you don't have to have attended this presentation or know, be a lawyer or know exactly what the law says to get FMLA leave or an ADA accommodation. Your employer should offer you FMLA leave as soon as it becomes aware of the fact that you have a condition or circumstance that qualifies as an FMLA covered reason for leave. So for example, if you tell your employer, your HR department or your supervisor or the appropriate person that you are having a baby in March, then the employer should be on notice that you have a FMLA covered reason and offer that leave to you. So they should take a proactive step to do that. Or, you know, if you were in some sort of accident, you're in a car accident and you're hospitalized, the employer should, and you make them aware of that, the employer should know that you have an FMLA, potentially FMLA covered reason for needing leave, and they should offer it to you. They should also begin the interactive process with you to determine if you have any ADA, a need for any ADA accommodations as soon as they become aware that you might need one. So again, you don't have to ask for this in any special way. You just have to make them aware of that you may need an ADA accommodation. And that interactive process is just kind of what it sounds like, a conversation, an interactive discussion between the employee and the employer to determine what accommodations the employee needs to do their job and how those reasonable accommodations can be provided by the employer. The unfortunate thing is that employers don't always know their obligations, that they have this proactive duty to do these things. So taking the following steps is a good idea if you're in need of FMLA leave or an ADA accommodation. Request that FMLA leave and or an ADA accommodation specifically and in writing. Again, you want to track these things or record these things to show that you've actually requested them. Send your request via email with a read receipt, via fax, or paper mail with a return receipt or delivery signature. And these are the best methods to send things for if you're submitting a written request so that you can show not only did you send it, but that the right person actually got it. And be sure to address your request to the appropriate person, like HR or your supervisor. The appropriate person varies based on the employer, but if you check your employee handbook, they usually have information about this. Or you can always ask somebody like your supervisor, who should a request like this go to so that you can make sure it gets to the right person. What should my ADA accommodation request include? Well, again, you don't have to use special language, but it doesn't hurt. Since you're already listening to this presentation, you might as well use that special language because you'll know it. A reference that you are requesting reasonable accommodation under the Americans with Disabilities Act or ADA is a good thing to put in there because it makes it clear and unequivocal that that's what you're looking for. You should also list what task or requirements you need accommodation with, the accommodations you need, the reason you need these accommodations, and how long you anticipate your need for the accommodations, if applicable. So that's more for things that might come and go, not permanent conditions. Like if you are permanently blind, you'll probably always need those accommodations. But for example, if you just had surgery and you only need, you know, your special chair for a few months, or you only need the standing accommodation for a few months, then you can specify that. Should I do anything after I request FMLA leave or an ADA accommodation? Yes, you should comply with requests for information from your employer. So if your employer asks you for updated information from your medical provider, a statement about when you might be back to work, all of those things, be sure to provide them and do so promptly. The thing about FMLA leave and ADA accommodations is they often require medical providers to submit documentation to your employer. And as anybody knows that's been to a doctor's office anytime recently, medical providers are extremely busy and deal with tons of paperwork. And a lot of times these can fall through the cracks or get mishandled. And unfortunately, in this employment context, the doctor or the healthcare worker's mistake or failure to do something quickly actually becomes the employee's problem. So be sure to follow up with the doctors or healthcare workers that you requested this documentation from and make sure that they are actually getting sent and provided to your employer. Emphasize to your healthcare provider the importance of these documents getting to your employer. You know, your employment could depend on it. And confirm that the documents have been received by your employer once they are sent. Most medical facilities operate using fax machines, which are historically dated and not extremely reliable. So there's a chance that they may have sent a fax and your employer never actually received it. So once the healthcare provider tells you that they've sent the information, follow up with your employer and just confirm that they've received it. So for FMLA, you should, while on leave, update your employer as necessary. So give them sufficient notice and information if you need additional leave, or just update them on your status if necessary. If you only took 3 weeks of your 12 weeks because you had surgery and expected to be back at 100% and back to work after that, but you're not healing as quickly and you need another week, give them notice as early and often as you can so that they don't have any excuse that you were uncooperative or did not provide the required information for them to adequately give you the leave. For the ADA, if you have new or different needs arise, update your employer as necessary and give them new appropriate supporting information. What type of information can your employer request? Your employer can seek information regarding the needs you have and specific recommendations to accommodate those needs for an ADA accommodation request. Does your employer have to provide the accommodation you ask for? No. An employer just has to provide a reasonable accommodation that does not impose an undue hardship on the company, but they're not necessarily required to provide exactly what you ask for. So they don't have to create a new job for you, excuse you from performing essential functions of your job, or lower production standards. Again, the employer and employee should engage in what's called the interactive process to determine what exact accommodations are reasonable for the employer. Some people ask, can employers require documentation of their medical condition for an ADA accommodation? Yes, an employer can require reasonable documentation. So that doesn't mean they get every medical record from you since the beginning of time, you know, your shot records from when you were a baby, but it does mean that they can and are entitled to get documentation to establish that you have an ADA-covered disability and that that disability necessitates a reasonable accommodation. And a lot of employers will use standard request forms that they'll send to your medical provider, have them complete and return. Can my employer require that I go to a specific medical provider to obtain documentation for an ADA accommodation? The answer to this is yes. An employer can require that you see a provider of their choice if you provide insufficient information to establish that you have an ADA disability and/or that your disability necessitates a reasonable accommodation. Your employer should explain why the documentation is insufficient and allow you the opportunity to provide that missing information in a timely manner instead of just forcing you to go to a provider of their choosing. But if it does come to that, they could ask you and require you to go to a provider of their choosing. Some people ask if they can use paid time off while they're on unpaid leave, because again, leave taken under the FMLA or leave that you might be given as a reasonable accommodation under the ADA, it's often unpaid. And the answer to that is probably. You can use paid time off as long as it's allowed by your employer's policies. So, you know, you have available PTO and it's permitted by an employee handbook or other policy to use that. Some people wonder if the employer can require you to use PTO while you're on unpaid leave, because a lot of times employers will require you to use paid time off while you're on unpaid leave. And they usually do that because they don't want you to take 12 weeks of time off under the FMLA and not get paid for it. And then you're supposed to return April 1st and all of a sudden you want to use the 3 weeks of vacation that you have and now you're not coming back till the end of April. And to the employer, that could be a big deal or it could become burdensome for them. So they don't want people to do that. So a lot of times the employers will have policies saying you have to use your paid time off if you take this unpaid leave, and they are well within their rights to do that. They may require you to do that. They also might just allow you to do it permissively. And for a lot of folks, they do want to use it because you want to get paid if you're taking time off and you need those funds. Disability insurance, how can you find out if you have it? You can ask your HR representative or benefits specialist. This information also may have been provided to you with your new hire or onboarding documents. Does your employer have to pay for disability insurance if they offer it? No, but a lot of employers offer these policies at the employee's expense. They may pay for it or pay for a part of it on your behalf if they choose. A lot of times they'll do this to attract or retain good employees as sort of an incentive or benefit. If your employer doesn't offer disability insurance, could you buy it on your own separately? Yes, a lot of different companies offer private disability insurance. The costs vary depending on age, health, job, and other factors. And these plans are usually much more expensive than an employer-sponsored plan, but they can be available if you would like to have that just in case. Can you use disability insurance benefits while you're on FMLA or ADA covered leave? Yes, you can usually get these disability insurance benefits from any policy that you have, but that, remember, that benefit for disability insurance is just going to provide usually a percentage of your pay. It does not protect your job like the FMLA or ADA will, but you can opt to obtain these benefits while you're on this unpaid leave to supplement your income. So you should contact your insurance provider to see how you start that process. How do you start the process of getting disability insurance benefits? You need to submit a claim to your disability insurance company. They'll require information about your disability, including documentation regarding your conditions. And they may also require an examination from a provider of their choice at their cost. Once the claim is approved, you should start receiving these benefits. Again, it's typically about 60% of your pay is what most plans have. And if your claim is denied, you can consult your plan documents to see if you have appeal rights and remedies and how to go about them. Finally, this seems like it's going to be a big part of the presentation, but it's not. Wrongful termination. Wrongful termination is something that people throw around the term a lot, but it doesn't actually really live up to what wrongful termination is under the law, at least the law in Texas or the Fifth Circuit, which is the federal circuit where Texas sits. Texas is an at-will employment state, and some people think that's unique, but it's not. Every other state in the U.S. also is an at-will employment state, except for Montana. What at-will employment means is that either the employee or the employer can terminate the employment relationship for nearly any reason or even no reason at all. This can be a kind of scary concept for an employee, that your employer can just fire you at any time for any reason or no reason, but it also gives employees the freedom to quit. The alternative to being at will is having contract employment, which could provide restraints on whether employees are able to quit, resign, or, you know, have the employment mobility that we have right now, where you can just go from one employer to another in an at will employment state. The only exception to the termination for any reason or no reason at all is that an employer may not terminate an employee for a reason that is prohibited by law. And generally, the only unlawful reasons for terminating an employee in Texas are unlawful discrimination and/or harassment. That's not any discrimination or harassment. So if your boss is annoying, or another coworker is annoying and you think their behavior is harassing, that does not necessarily mean it's unlawful harassment. I'll get into specifics of what unlawful harassment and discrimination are shortly, but it's not any form of discrimination or harassment. Retaliation for complaints of unlawful discrimination and or harassment. Retaliation for protected wage complaints. So like we discussed earlier, those complaints under the Fair Labor Standards Act, telling your employer you think you're entitled to overtime, that you've been underpaid, that you're entitled to more compensation. Or retaliation in violation of a whistleblower statute. So discrimination and harassment are the most common types of wrongful termination claims. Again, not all discrimination and harassment is unlawful. Somebody's just a jerk. They might just be a jerk. They're not a law-violating jerk. Not every employer is prohibited from discriminating or harassing employees or potential employees. And I know this sounds really crazy, but like the FMLA or the ADA, an employer has to be a covered employer for you to have protection from discrimination and harassment. And what that means is the employer has to have 15 or more employees. So for example, if you worked for an Italian restaurant and the employer hired you because they thought you were Italian, you work there for a couple of weeks, they find out you're Greek, you're not Italian, and the employer says, we only want Italian employees, you're fired. If the employer only has 10 employees, they're not a covered employer, and they're firing you for not being Italian, which would be potentially national origin discrimination for a covered employer, is not a claim that you can bring against them because they're not a covered employer. They have less than 15 employees. So if you're working for a small business, you are probably not protected from discrimination and harassment, even if it's unlawful, because your employer won't be a covered employer unless they have 15 or more employees. What is unlawful discrimination or harassment? Again, I said it's not everything, so what is it? It's less favorable treatment that must be based on a protected characteristic or activity and unreasonably interfere with work performance and or create a work environment that's intimidating, hostile, or offensive. So it's treating someone less favorably because of protected characteristic, but what are those protected characteristics? By law, they are race, color, religion, sex or gender, sexual orientation, gender identity, pregnancy, national origin, age, disability, citizenship status, and veteran status. And this chart shows the different types of charges filed with the EEOC for discrimination and harassment. And as you can see, disability, race, and sex are overwhelmingly the most popular claims that people make of discrimination and harassment that occur in the workplace. What is protected activity? Well, it's making a complaint about discrimination or harassment, providing information during an investigation, testifying in connection with a complaint, or filing a charge of discrimination or a lawsuit. What is retaliation? So as an employee, you might be protected from retaliation, but what does that look like? It's any adverse action against an employee because the individual engaged in a protected activity. So again, made a complaint, testified, provided information in an investigation. Most people think of retaliation as a firing or a demotion, but it can take many forms. And really any adverse action or retaliation, almost any adverse action or retaliation is protected by law. Any action that would deter a reasonable person in the same situation from making a complaint can be retaliation. So examples of retaliation can be things like taunting, isolation, cutting someone's pay, hostility toward an employee just because they engage in a protected activity. So it doesn't have to just be firing or demotion. What are whistleblower statutes? Because that's another form of protection. These are specific prohibitions on retaliation against employees who make good faith complaints or report on issues of public interest. And these are very specific things. So the SEC or Dodd-Frank Act is one whistleblower statute or set of whistleblower protections. So is the Texas Health and Safety Code. It contains some whistleblower protections for certain employees, most specifically hospital employees. OSHA is a common one. A lot of people know about workplace safety complaints that have whistleblower protections. And the Surface Transportation Assistance Act, this one applies to commercial drivers, and a typical whistleblower complaint you'll see under the STAA or STA is companies requiring employees to work or drive over the amount of hours of service they're allowed to under that Surface Transportation Assistance Act. So what can you do if you've been subject to discrimination and harassment or whistleblower retaliation? Well, if you've been subject to discrimination or harassment, you can file a charge of discrimination with the TWC, the Texas Workforce Commission, and or the EEOC, Equal Employment Opportunity Commission. An important thing to note here is that a maximum of 300 days to file your charge of discrimination from the date of the most recent adverse action, so your termination, your firing, the date you got demoted, the date you got denied a promotion, that's when your deadline will start running. And while you have a maximum of 300 days, it's better to do this as soon as possible and preferably within 180 days to preserve any and all remedies you might have under the applicable state and federal statutes, and also to preserve certain venues that you might be able to have that might be better for you if and when you do have to file a lawsuit down the line. You can also file a lawsuit once the applicable prerequisites are complete. So some things require you to first file a charge with TWC and or the EEOC before filing a lawsuit. Other things don't, like FMLA denial or interference is something that you can file a lawsuit on without first filing a charge with the EEOC or TWC. But some other things like race discrimination require you to file that charge and get authorization from that agency to file your lawsuit. Whistleblower retaliation. If you've been subject to that, you should review the applicable whistleblower statute and program rules closely and comply, meaning file a complaint or do whatever those rules say. What's important about whistleblower statutes is they usually have really short timelines and strict compliance procedures. Some of these deadlines are as short as 30 days from the date you engaged in protected activity or were subject to an adverse action. So pay close attention and act quickly on whistleblower matters. And typically after that, you will proceed with administrative procedures, usually through the Department of Labor or other agency, depending on the whistleblower statute. This is a broad overview. These things are complex. There's limitations periods that apply. It's a good idea to contact an attorney as soon as possible if you believe you've been subject to unlawful discrimination or harassment. And as promised, long presentation, definitely went over time, but I am happy to answer any questions that you may have, and I'll look for them in the chat over the next minute or so. All right, so a question came in. Is there any scenario in which a union collective bargaining agreement would prevail over an Equal Employment Opportunity Commission or other federal statute or regulation? That's a great question. It wouldn't necessarily prevail. I want to make sure I'm reading the question correctly. It wouldn't necessarily prevail over that. But sometimes collective bargaining agreements can have different provisions in them for their own internal investigations. And sometimes you can and should follow those steps. But generally, you cannot be precluded from filing a charge of discrimination with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission or Texas Workforce Commission based on any of the things that they investigate. So the protected categories and protected activity. And that is a very broad right that typically is cannot even be waived in a settlement agreement. You will still have the right to pursue an Equal Employment Opportunity Commission charge of discrimination, because the goal of the EEOC when it was established was not just to address discrimination as it's happening to the person, but to also address systemic discrimination that may be occurring in the workplace and have a broad application. So there's a lot of different public policies that say there's really nothing that can make you foreclose your right to pursue an EEOC charge and pursue the remedies that you're entitled to under that. You can sometimes be precluded from certain monetary settlement provisions or be required to arbitrate if you have an arbitration agreement, but just filing a charge with the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission or availing yourselves of federal statutory protections should not be waived by a collective bargaining agreement. Great question. Okay, I do not think we have any more questions. I think that was the last only one, probably because I talked way too much. And so the only final slide I have is connect with us. If you're interested in learning more about our medical legal partnership, you can access our website here. There's a QR code if you have a device that can scan it, that'll take you right to it. Follow us on Instagram at Lone Star Legal Aid, on Facebook, facebook.com/Lone Star Legal Aid, or call us if you're interested in seeing if you qualify for our services. Thank you so much for your time. I hope this helps you maybe navigate employment problems that you may be having, or at least make you feel empowered so that these issues may not come up in your employment, or if they do, you know how to address them. Take care.